I'm doing a Jeffrey Robertson here. In your opinion, where would India be today if the British did not step into India?
Oh, there's a lot there. It'll take the rest of the program to answer. I'll try and touch on it. But this is almost like the American saying to the widow of the American president, apart from that, Mrs. Lincoln, how did you enjoy the play? I mean, you know, really, the British came to one of the richest countries in the world, accounting for 27% of global GDP in 1700, 23% in 1800, and over 200 years of exploitation, depredation, loot and destruction reduced it to a poster child for third world poverty, just over 3% of global GDP, 90% of the population living below the poverty line when the British left in 1947, a literacy rate, you speak of education, a literacy rate below 17%, and a life expectancy of 27. The growth rate of British India from 1900 to 1947 was 0.001%. That's what they were doing while draining the country of taxes and resources. Education, my gosh, the British, the last thing they wanted to do was invest in educating Indians. Will Durant, the American historian traveling in India as late as 1930, pointed out that the entire expenditure of the British on education in India, from the nursery level to the highest universities, was less than half the high school budget of the state of New York. All the Indian Institutes of Technology, the engineering achievements you're talking about, were established after independence by the government of India. There is simply no comparison between the accomplishments of India rising from the ashes the British left us in and what was done in 200 years.
Just take one example, the textile industry, because India was a huge exporter of
For 2,000 years, it was the world's leading exporter.
What happened?
In fact, in the Roman Empire, there are debates recorded by Pliny the Elder of Roman senators complaining about the amount of the Roman Empire's gold that was being sent off to India because of the tastes of Roman women for Indian muslins, linens and cottons.
Was it just modernism, the Industrial Revolution that destroyed it, or was it something else?
No, that's the excuse that apologists like to make, that, you know, oh, it's not our fault, you just missed the bus for the Industrial Revolution. Well, we missed the bus because you threw us under its wheels, is what I tell the Brits. I mean, the fact is, in the name of free trade, the British came in and destroyed the free trade that had made India a leading exporter of textiles. The British soldiers smashed the looms so people couldn't practice their craft. They imposed punitive duties and taxes on the export of Indian textiles while lifting duties on the import of British cloth. And they achieved a captive market at the point of a gun. This is not exactly free trade, as you can imagine. Cities like Murshidabad and Dhaka in the subcontinent were depopulated. In one notorious incident, weavers had their thumbs cut off, so when the looms were repaired, they couldn't weave again. Textiles were systematically destroyed as an industry by the British. And that's only one example of many.
I'm going to quickly go back to, and I'm just wondering, have young Brits come to terms with their colonial past?
No, we haven't at all. Young Brits of every class have no idea about our colonial past, and that is being deliberately done. We are deliberately denied or, you know, kept away from education about the graphic facts of what the British did around the world, you know, including in this country, to the people of this country. The crimes of the British and the crimes of that we committed and that were done in our names over 400 years of pillage and conquest is something that we don't like to think about, and yet it is everywhere in modern British history. When people talk about Brexit, it's stunning to me that if you ask British people who voted for Brexit what their major fear is, their fear is that people will come to our country and take our things.
Mm. And that's exactly,
like, you know, why? Yeah. I just can't. It doesn't compute, but we don't know this history. You know, I took history in British schools up to the age of 18, and I got a pretty good grade. And most
of... You never learned a line of colonial history, did you?
Well, almost everything that you have just said, I learned from your book.
I'm going to throw quickly back to Shashi, because, you know, one of the great heroes of the Second World War, in fact, of the 20th century, Winston Churchill, you've basically accused him in your book of complicity in a famine that killed 4 million Bengalis.
Rightly so.
4.3. I mean, Churchill personally took the decisions that actually not only plunged Bengal into starvation, but had the British actually purchase grain that the Bengalis could barely afford to buy in order to ship it to Europe, not to aid the war effort, as his defenders claim, but to boost the buffer stocks in the event of a future possible invasion of Greece and Yugoslavia. People started dying, and Churchill said, well, it's all their fault anyway for breeding like rabbits. He said, I hate the Indians. They're a beastly people with a beastly religion. Oh, Australian ships were docking in Calcutta port and were ordered by Churchill and his odious paymaster general, Lord Chobel, not to disembark their wheat, but to sail on to Europe, where their wheat might be used in some future reserve stock. On top of that, when conscience-stricken
did Churchill know people would die?
Yes, conscience-stricken British officials are constantly sending memoranda to the Prime Minister personally, because it was his decision, saying that people were dying literally on the streets. And all Churchill could bring himself to do was write peevishly on the side of the file, why hasn't Gandhi died yet?
Wow.
And this is the man the British want us to hail as an apostle of freedom and democracy, when he has as much blood on his hands as some of the worst genocidal dictators of the 20th century.
Well, thank you.